The next item on the order paper is a motion on ending the separation of paramilitary prisoners at HMP McGabbery. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the Marshall list. The proposer will have 10 minutes to propose the amendment and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly notes that HMP McGabbery is unique in the British Isles and much of Europe for the challenges it faces as a result of housing prisoners with such opposing political and ideological views and criminal backgrounds. Further notes the continuing implementation of a flawed decision taken in 2003 to separate paramilitary prisoners and the impact that this is having on the operation of the prison and on the morale of public servants who live with its consequences. Believes that the prison should gradually revert back to its integrationist policy and that this should be reflected in the Executive's action plan on tackling paramilitary activity, criminality and organised crime, and calls on the Minister of Justice to put in place the framework to ensure that by 2021 there are no new admissions to separate paramilitary wings and that by 2026 there is a fully integrated prison regime.
Thank the clerk. I call Mr Doug Beattie to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. I must stand first of all and praise our prison service for their dedication, for their diligence, for their professionalism and for their courage in the most difficult environment and circumstances. And I must also pay tribute to the families of serving prison officers who have been killed on duty. They have taken their hardship with great dignity, and they should not be forgotten. Mr. Speaker, this motion is in support of the Executive. This supports DUP and it supports Sinn Féin. It supports the Fresh Start and it supports the plan for tackling paramilitary activity, criminality and organised crime. In the Fresh Start it says, "We'll work collectively to achieve a society free of paramilitarism, disbandment of all paramilitary organisations and their structures, challenge paramilitary attempts to control communities and accept no authority, direction or control on our political activities other than our democratic mandate." It supports the action plan on paramilitaries. It is important in taking forward this work that we keep in mind the ambitious outcomes that we are seeking to achieve, ultimately a society where citizens and communities feel safe and confident, where paramilitarism has no place. No place. So my motion dovetails into the Fresh Start and my motion dovetails into the action plan. And we aren't here because we wanted to be here with this issue. It was thrust upon us. And it was a thrust upon us if we reach back. Yes, of course.
Appreciate the member giving way. The member be aware that prison officers don't have a trade union as such. They have a staff association, POA. I'm just wondering, could the member detail for the House, have the Prison Officers Association approved the content of the motion that's been brought before the Assembly today?
I thank you for your comments. I have spoken to individual members, and individual members have accepted what I am bringing forward and agree with what I am bringing forward. The Steele report, and I throw this back to the Steele report. The Steele report came out at a time where these devolved institutions had collapsed. There was a fair degree of security concerns and safety concerns. And the government instigated the Steele report, and in 1 month they decided we revert back to a separated regime. And 12 days later, that's where we went. They did so against the recommendations of the Prison Officers Association, against the Governors Association and the Northern Ireland Affairs Committee. All of them were against it. But their rationale was they brought in the separated regime because of health and safety, safety for the prisoners. although those institutions I've just told you said that there was no issue. But here's an interesting thing for you all, and here's probably the real reason why we went back to the separated regime. And this was said by Mr. Steele himself. It was clear to me and a lot of people that they, the paramilitaries, were about to mount a campaign inside and outside the prison. I expected that if they were denied separation, those would be steadily get worse, and indeed that it would escalate to attacks on prison officers. There's the reason we went back to a separated regime, and this view was perpetuated by Sinn Féin. And here we have yet again terrorists holding the gun to the head of Northern Ireland society and say, do as we say or we will return to violence. Yes.
I appreciate the member giving way. Will he agree with me that in August 2010, when the then Justice Minister David Ford reached what was called the August Agreement, that he gave further concessions to the Republicans, and it was the same argument that was used as was used by the Steele report?
I thank you very much for your intervention, and I'm just about to step into that little nugget now, if I may, because I'm looking at the Sinn Féin amendment. And the Sinn Féin amendment is full of great words, and I've got to say, it's easy to support the words, and I do support some of the words, because they recognise that all prisoners and all prison staff must be treated with dignity and respect. And the agreed principles that the member talked about in August 2010 are virtually the same, because they stated arrangements are predicated on mutual respect, prisoners and staff safety must not be put at risk. 2010. How did that work out? I'll tell you how that worked out. That worked out with the death of Prison Officer Black. That worked out with the death of Prison Officer Ismay. That worked out with numerous prison officers being targeted for murder. The amendment also goes on to say that they support the planned independent review to examine the operation of the separated regime. Now, this would be Bravo 8 of the action plan, but it addresses the framework of the separated regime. It doesn't talk about ending it. But here's where we are. No independent reviewer has been nominated. No one's been found yet. No process has been put in place to find one. No resources have been put in place to get one. We haven't taken a single step forward. We don't even have a term of reference. Well, you know what? I'm going to start with the term of reference. And the term of reference is my motion. Let's end it. The Ulster Unionist Party believes that the continuation of the separated regime gives paramilitaries an identity, a centre of gravity, a credibility, a perceived credibility, and an ability to direct terrorism from inside the prison on society outside of the prison. Now, I know it's difficult to come up with a plan to end that. My plan is 9 years. 9 years! It took them 1 month to force this on us, and I'm looking 9 years to get rid of it. Now, if I'm going to take criticism, I'll take criticism because I'm suggesting 9 years, where I know there may be people here who think it should be done straight away or done within this mandate. But I say 9 years because people need time to get used to it. Between now and the end of the mandate, it's about making sure people understand the idea of ending the separated regime. And then at the end of this mandate, it is about stopping new prisoners going into that regime. And then that gives us a full mandate to get into integration. It challenges the status quo. It feeds in to the fresh start. And it feeds in to the action plan of paramilitarism. But there are issues, and I step up to those issues. First of all, the Secretary of State is the man who decides who goes or who does not go into that prison. Well, we're the elected representatives. We represent the people, and if we don't want it, then we need to stop it. And we need to go to the Secretary of State if that's the thing we have to do. We must go to the Justice Minister. We must tell them we don't want it anymore. We want a normalised society. That's what the people want. That is what we should be delivering. Should there be an All-Ireland solution? Can we have no separated regime in Northern Ireland while they have one in the Irish Republic? Well, do you know what? This is something we have to talk about, and that's why I'm talking 9 years from now. 9 years. I keep saying that. 9 years. Should we be flexible if in 2026 that some of our prisoners who have been in separated regime for a long time are still in jail? I think we can be flexible. I think we should allow them to see their time out in that regime. But here's a telling quote, if I may, from a minister in 2007, 4 years after separation. The minister acknowledges that it would be desirable to see separation phased out as our political situation improved. I'm hoping it's improved. But he was quite clear that he did not envisage any early end to separation. We believe that ending separation should be a high priority for those responsible for criminal justice after devolution, and we would welcome an early debate on this issue amongst Northern Ireland politicians.
Ask the member to conclude his remarks.
Do I not get a minute?
No.
I shall conclude, thank you.
I call Mr. Declan Kearney to move the amendment. Mr. Kearney.
McGilvray Prison is indeed unique on these islands. However, what should take primacy for us as legislators and political leaders is to ensure that all prison staff, all prisoners, their families and visitors to this prison are treated with dignity and respect. The penal system is one of democratic society's responses to the social context which produces offenders. Prison is not simply about punishment of offenders, but also rehabilitation and reorientation in order to assist their transition back into society. Yes, prison is a societal punishment, but not at the cost of dehumanising or degrading the rights of prisoners or prison staff. That must be the guiding vision and purpose of how prisons, including McGilvray, should be run. The history of prisons in this state is one of well-documented conflict. One lesson learned is to ensure that prisons do no longer contribute to more or future political or communal instability. There have been significant changes to prison life in the north, and that includes McGilvray Prison, placing responsibility for prisons under the control of the local executive since 2008 has played an important role in promoting penal reform here. But while prison reform is ongoing, it's neither completed or comprehensive, and that applies especially to McGilvray Prison. Comprehensive prison reform should be at the heart of the political and policy framework for the Department of Justice and for this Assembly. Today's UUP motion completely misses both the context and the necessary reform agenda. A prison reform based upon approaches which should make maximum use of all the available resources as necessary in order to progress that agenda. So that means listening to the Prisons Ombudsman, working closely with Probation Board, NIACRO, the Children's Law Centre, by learning and being guided by penal reform experts and engaging with other authoritative agencies. Importantly, the process of prison reform should be set in context, not at the moment, with the Fresh Start Agreement, and specifically with the planned independent review as proposed by the panel on the disbandment of paramilitary groups. But then, of course, the UUP opposed the Fresh Start Agreement. The change champions within our prison service need to be politically supported by the Department of Justice and the Assembly. Sinn Féin will work constructively with the Minister, other parties and all agencies who are committed to positive change in McGilvray and in all of our other penal institutions. In terms of McGilvray, this requires that management and operational systems are reformed. The security mindset, which continues to dominate, needs to be replaced by a rehabilitative culture. Let me also be very clear on this particular point. No prison officer should be subject to threats, intimidation, or harmed in any way at work or away from work. Prison officers are public servants from whom we expect the highest professional standards and accountability for prisoners' welfare and safety. They, in turn, deserve to be treated with respect and dignity and to depend upon our support. However, transparency, consistency and adherence to best practice and human rights, and I emphasise human rights, must also be at the heart of how McGabbery Prison is run. In recent weeks, shocking and unacceptable failures within this prison have been brought to public attention. And much of this has been extensively scrutinised by the Justice Committee, I'm glad to say, and also discussed here on the floor of the Assembly. The case of Sean Kelly was an unacceptable travesty. The treatment shown him was inhumane. It was absolutely wrong. The internal prison inquiry was deficient, and questions still remain to be answered. There was a complete breakdown. There was a complete breakdown between the prison and the health services, and an absence of proper medical supervision contributed to the death of Patrick Kelly. As a result of the Ombudsman's investigations into these cases, greater attention has been drawn to significant mental health concerns in McGabbery Prison. The Department of Justice, Public Prosecution Service, this Assembly and society as a whole must look at sentencing and committal arrangements for people who are mentally ill and who should not be sent to jail. McGabbery Prison should not be used as society's default option. Prison officers cannot be expected to manage complex cases when the proper skills and facilities do not exist within the prison service itself. However, there are other issues which should give us all serious cause for concern in relation to conditions within McGabbery. Prisoners on integrated wings report habitual 23-hour-a-day lock-up with only 1 hour for recreation or association. They are obliged to eat 3 daily meals in the cell space, which also occupies their toilet. The routine prison diet has little or no nutritional value. Young prisoners in McGabbery have reported to me that a lunch typically consists of a small bread sandwich containing a Spam filling with no butter and a small bag of crisps. And whilst education facilities have improved, and I want to commend the commitment of outside educationalists in that respect, prisoners who wish to attend classes have told me about difficulties in doing so. Prisoners report that parity of esteem does not exist for the Irish cultural identity, particularly with respect to the Irish language and language learning resources, and that has been confirmed in the July 2016 report by the CGI. Bacor Gomeo Masarakela, the Ahan tradition, Insan Acho, Insan Statshaw, Na Prison Akoharihe. Controlled movement and strip searching in row house also remains a serious problem. Such practices dehumanise both prisoners and also prison staff. The template agreed in August 2010 between prisoners and prison staff should be revisited because it contains the basis for resolution of these issues which create avoidable and unnecessary stress and conflict within the prison context. The prison environment should be kept free from outside political interference, including that of the NIO, which is currently using McGabbery Prison to wrongfully detain Tony Taylor on an extrajudicial basis. Members, we need to be de-escalating and resolving contentious issues and practices in McGabbery, not compounding problems. And this UUP motion offers no properly thought-out approach for how that can be done. Our focus as an Assembly should be upon making McGabbery a stable, a stress-free and safe environment for all staff, for all prisoners and all of those who visit the prison. Commitment to continuing comprehensive prison reform based upon principles of human dignity, Decency and respect must be paramount. That is what this Assembly should be working to achieve. That is what this Assembly should be debating today. That is the change agenda required in McGabbery, and what the Department of Justice must be accountable for delivering and demonstrating under the leadership of the Justice Minister. Mullum an Leasú.
I call Mr Paul Frew.
Speaker, and certainly this motion from the UUP, it's something that, of course, we have aspired to achieve for many, many years, from manifesto to manifesto, with regards to ending separation of prisoners in McGabbery. The decision was taken in 2004 by the Her Majesty's Government at that time, and there was options looked at. At that time, one of them was reopening the Mayes prison to allow for separated prisoners. And of course, we could not ever support going back to the days of the Mayes and the regimes within them. Can I just say at first that we owe a large debt of gratitude to the prison staff who work day in, day out, in our prisons, not only in McGabbery, of course, but right across our prison estate. They do a tremendous piece of work which I don't think anyone in the public, outside of their families, will actually realise the tremendous work they do. And if there's a message that needs to go out of here today, is that we support you, we respect you, and we will try and do everything we can to better support you in your day job. And of course, it's not only a day job. Prison service are faced every hour with risk of death, of assassination, to be blown to smithereens. And that is something which I suspect is unbearable at times for families and for the prison staff involved, both male and female, of course. Yes, I will. Yeah.
Thank you, Member for giving way. Was it not something that really galled both prison officers' families and the wider Northern Ireland public whenever the report that concluded McGabbery was the most dangerous prison also claimed that prison officers here are under no greater threat than any other part of the United Kingdom? And was the death of Adrian Ismay not a very clear indication that our prison officers are operating under a very different regime from any other part of the United Kingdom?
Member has an extra minute.
I think the member for his intervention, he's absolutely right. That's pie in the sky to think that our prison service operate in the same climate as in mainland UK, or anywhere else, in fact, in Europe. And that is not the case. But also, we want to see an end to paramilitarism. We want to see an end to organised criminality. We want to see an end to any sort of terrorist organisations or activity. Now, how do we achieve that? Because we've all said we want an end to it, but how do we operate and work to get that achieved? And I think, at the minute, our best bet, our best way of achieving that is through the Fresh Start Agreement and the Executive Action Plan, which has been published. That is our roadmap, not only to ending the separation in our prisons, but also to ending paramilitarism in its entirety. But let me say this. If there's paramilitaries out there, of whatever hue, and they're conducting terrorist organisation or terrorist activities, I want them arrested. I want them imprisoned. And I want them out of harm's way. There should also be a message, leave this room today, that we are not back in the days of the Mayes. Prisoners cannot dig tunnels, cannot store soil in a cell. It is controlled by the prison staff. McGabbery is controlled by the very staff that we place in there to protect us.
Yes, I will. Yeah. I thank the
the member for giving way. I'd just like to get his thought of what he thinks about special treatment for paramilitaries when everybody else is locked down at lunchtime and dissident Republicans are out playing football. Does he think that's fair, right? Do we think it should continue?
I thank the member for the intervention, but that's the message that shouldn't be going out here, because it's not special status. That's the point that I'm making. They are separated. It is not special. I have been in Row House. I have been in Bush House. They are locked down. They are able to move in threes and fours. That is all. The prison authorities have control. And it would be a mistake for some paramilitary organisation to get publicity out of this in the fact that we think that they control the prison. They do not, and they will not, because the prison authorities have it under control. They do not control Row House. The loyalists do not control Bush House. But I must say, there's a lot of psychological warfare going on. There's absolutely no doubt about it. They can pick on individual prison officers. That is wrong. But that is the calibre of the prisoner that we're talking about in that regard. Yes, I will.
It's interesting to hear the member so assured that there is no control. Is part of the cancer within the prisons not that the prison system creates an aura of Mr. Biggs in the prison? And then when they're out in the streets, they still think they're Mr. Biggs, who can dictate to government as well as everyone else.
The member's time is up.
Okay.
We call Mr. Alex Atwood.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The SDLP had submitted an amendment to the All Students motion in an attempt to manage this issue comprehensively across the island and across the multiple issues that we have to manage. And it is my view that when it comes to dealing with issues that have this sort of character, it's best that the Chamber would have been able to hear all of the voices in that regard. So I want to address what it is that we would have been proposing in an effort to try to navigate through this very difficult issue. The first is, and I would ask the Minister to reply to this in her response, there is two separate regimes on the island of Ireland. The proposer referred to this. And it is the view of the SDLP that if we're going to deal with the issue of separation, and the SDLP believes that it should be addressed, that it needs to be as best as possible addressed across the island of Ireland. And therefore, I'd ask the Minister to meet with the Minister of Justice and Equality in the Republic in Ireland in order to discuss where they see the issue of separation going, so that we try as best as possible to manage this in a coherent and common way as we go forward. The second issue is that it may have been that this motion may have been less acute if the independent review that had been endorsed by the executive in the middle of July had actually been commenced by now. And I'd ask the Minister to advise where are we in respect of the independent review, because it was indicated to committee, the Justice Committee last week, that as of now, a person has not been appointed in order to conduct that review. And given that that is part and parcel of the three-panel report, I think we need to have action, or action quickly, in respect of the review. The third question I would ask the Minister is, how is the current system of separation operating with regard to those who seek to enter into a separated regime in the prison? Because people of far greater authority than I, who observe and are involved in the management of prisoners, say to me and say to others that those who seek to benefit, as they might see it, from the separated regime, rather casually are able to do so, and that there is a lack of rigour in terms of the assessment of a prisoner going into prison as to whether that prisoner should or should not be permitted into the separated regime. It is becoming a matter of first choice and easy option, and that's not the purpose for which the separated regime was established. And I would remind the Minister that this issue has been interrogated by the Irish court system when it comes to the separate regime that exists in Portlaoise, to the point where a court decided that a person seeking a separate regime in Portlaoise wasn't going to be allowed to have that option. So I think there's a need for a robust management of the current regime as we move beyond, if that is the decision, of a different regime. And that was the spirit and the content of what the SDLP would have proposed. And in my view, that would have been a more comprehensive way, even more comprehensive than the words being used by Sinn Féin, in order to navigate a way through this. Because navigate a way through this is what we have to do. Because this issue is part of the residue of paramilitarism in our society, and that all of the issues that arise from that residue need to be addressed. I know the reasons why those students have brought this forward, but in our view, some of the language being used by those students doesn't best serve the outcome that is required in this situation. And as I say, in our view, what we would have proposed goes beyond where Sinn Féin are. I say all those comments, Mr. Speaker, in the context that I think there should be a moderate tone in this debate today.
Member concludes
and
remarks.
The reason there should be a moderate tone is that we are talking in the shadow of a murder in the streets of Belfast, and that both should focus our minds on the issue of paramilitarism and moderate our language when we come to debate this matter.
Call Mr. Trevor Lunn.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'll deal with the motion first. We like this motion. We would support it. That's not to say it's perfect. It does refer to the flawed decisions taken in 2003, and I think Mr. Beattie referred to subsequent decisions by the previous Justice Minister. All I would say about that is that the decisions were taken by people who knew what they were talking about in the best interests of security and health and safety within the prison. And if they turned out to be flawed, it doesn't mean to say that they were automatically flawed to start with. It's a really difficult area, and I suspect that the current minister is going to have to deal with it as a difficult area as well. The other members have referred to the situation around prison staff, and I would join with them. There is nobody in our society, apart from perhaps PSNI officers, who have had to suffer the level of threat, intimidation and strain and stress on their everyday lives that prison staff have had to suffer. Maybe it's because I'm in a Lisburn MLA and others would perhaps say the same thing, but we do hear a lot from prison staff on these issues, including some who have had to retire prematurely because of activities that have happened within these separated regimes in McGilvray. So I absolutely agree that we should make every effort to come up with an integrationist solution and to end the separation as soon as possible. Now, the motion refers to timescales 2021 and 2026 to finish all separation. I mean, who could argue with that? If we can't solve this situation within 10 years, frankly, what are we doing here? How many current prisoners will still be there in 10 years' time and clinging on to some kind of separationist status? It's time to move on this. So I thank the Ulster Unionists for bringing this motion before us. It also refers to an executive action plan. Well, sometimes I think that's frankly a contradiction in terms, but not to say that perhaps this review, if it eventually starts, and it is already 5 months behind time, may produce some fruit. It may not just sit on a shelf somewhere gathering dust, because it's too important for that. The panel that reported made various recommendations, not all to do with separation. In fact, the one that they made on separation was pretty bland, wasn't it? I mean, it was pretty vague. It just said that they should revisit the framework relating to the separated regime and arrange for an independent review. It didn't commit itself very much. It didn't commit itself at all except to set up a review. I think we could have looked for more than that from the panel, but there we are. The amendment, we don't really have any difficulty with the amendment, except perhaps it doesn't go far enough. It does refer to prisoners with diverse backgrounds who are subject to different court processes, depending on the nature of their charges. Well, I'm sorry for the proposer, but as far as I'm concerned, a criminal is a criminal. If he's in McGabbery because he was sentenced to be there, the nature of the court doesn't really matter, and this notion of political status and separation should be far behind us by now. And we don't need that, but the rest of the motion...
So,
yeah?
Would the member not agree that within McGabbery, not all prisoners are exactly the same or have exactly the same status? Would he factor the case of Mr. Tony Taylor into his argument about all prisoners being the same in McGabbery? Some have had due process, some have not had due process.
Member has an extra minute.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, that's just it's a matter of opinion, isn't it? I mean, I see a prisoner in McGabbery as a prisoner in McGabbery, and they should all be treated the same way and have the same status. That I find that not a hard argument to defend. But the amendment is and it's taken to get to the same solution without actually saying so, and without timescales. I think by the wording of evidencing the need for any changes and providing useful information to stakeholders to take forward as proposed by the report, hopefully we're all heading in the same direction in this. We're all on the same journey. We'd like to see normalisation of our prison regime, and whether we do it on the basis of fixed timescales or whether we do it on the basis of ongoing deliberations, surely it's not beyond us to have this settled within 10 years or 9 years, as Mr. Beattie said. I say it as 10 years, but you know, we will support the motion, absolutely. We won't vote against the Sinn Féin amendments, but we'll have to see what way the House goes on. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Call Mrs. Pam Cameron.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I rise as Deputy Chair and also a DUP member to speak on this motion today. Since 1986, Her Majesty's Prison McGabbery has served to accommodate remand prisoners and those paramilitary prisoners not released under the Belfast Agreement. During the summer of 2003, a number of prisoners, largely dissident Republicans, staged a series of protests aimed at reinstating the former May style of segregation and pushing for political prisoner status. A number of incidents occurred, including assaults, planting of hoax devices, damage to cells, intimidation of officers, escalating to rooftop protests and dirty protests. This, coupled with demonstrations at the prison gates, attacks on officers' homes and sending of a parcel bomb to the prison, the government commissioned the Steel Review to look at the conditions within the prison. The findings of the report were accepted by the Secretary of State and the process of segregation quickly implemented. These changes caused immediate concern amongst prison officers. Indeed, the Prison Officers Association at the time described it as a retrograde step. To my mind, it seemed that the voices of the people who we are relying on to deal with the changes on the ground were completely ignored. Whilst the changes were implemented with the safety and welfare of paramilitary prisoners in mind, it appears that the well-being and security of officers was disregarded, a position which continues to this day. The separation of prisoners takes up a disproportionate amount of resources, with staffing of separate units prioritised over the rest of the prison. Recent cases such as Paddy Kelly, who overdosed in March 2015, and Sean Lynch, who blinded himself in custody, highlight the need for prison reform and a need to look at the mental health issues of both prisoners and staff members. I'll use the phrase ordinary prisoners, particularly those who are vulnerable, are being put at risk due to additional pressures being put on the officers in monitoring the separated paramilitary wings. I've spoken to a number of serving prison officers in recent months, all of whom have highlighted the incredibly challenging conditions that they are working under. We are aware that due to the retirement and the high sickness levels that a large number of staff have left the service. The newly recruited staff, following initial training, are learning on the job without the support of more experienced staff to fall back on. Coupled with a cut in the budget for training, we're left with staff who are overstretched and ill-equipped to deal with this incredibly difficult and specialised job. High staff turnover and sickness levels add to the pressures. Indeed, to quote one of my constituents, people view a job in the prison service as a stepping stone before they apply to the PSNI. I believe that the morale is incredibly low within the service, which is something that must be addressed in order to advance a more settled regime for officers and prisoners alike. Any move towards ending the separation of paramilitary prisoners must be done primarily with the emphasis on ensuring the well-being and safety of the prisoners and of the staff. It is encouraging to note that since the unannounced inspection of the prison in May 2015, standards appear to have improved, and I hope the situation is one that continues. There is no doubt that McGabbery is a completely unique prison dealing with a completely unique set of circumstances. I do have concerns at ending the separation of prisoners, as it will need to be handled very carefully. It could be said that there is a catch-22 situation at play, and to change the status quo will require a considerable amount of dialogue, not only with prisoners themselves, but also with the associated organisations on the outside to ensure that change is received and implemented in a safe and non-violent manner for both prisoners and officers. In closing, Mr Speaker, the situation at McGabbery is entirely like no other, and therefore any change to the regime is sure to be fraught with difficulties. There is a significant job to be carried out before an ending of separation is undertaken. The construction of the new cell block at the prison may present an opportunity to implement change upon its 2019 handover. In the interim, I do hope the Minister will engage with the review and subsequent reform process. The move to a normalised prison community will not be an easy process, but I feel that in doing so, we will be taking a further step forward into the future of Northern Ireland. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
Call Mr Raymond McCartney.
Good. Colin Cooler, thank you very much, Mr Speaker. First of all, I will be speaking in favour, in support of the amendment, and indeed in opposition to the main motion tabled in the names of the Ulster Unionists. I think we come at the amendment, and very, very central to our is that there is already in place an independent review. So I think even the points which have been outlined this morning, I think the place to take them to is to the independent review, because I think it's where all of us can inform whatever decisions which will be made in relation to it. Certainly we will be bringing to that review when it's in place the same logic that we brought in 2003, the same logic that we brought when there was a resolution in August 2010, and the same logic that we brought to the Ann Orr's prison reform in 2011. And I think everyone should do that when they're having this discussion. The Ulster Unionists, in my opinion, if you like, sort of try to predetermine the outcome of the review. Let's have the review and let's let everybody have their input. The points made can be made through that review, and then let them determine what's the best way forward. One of the things, and I just want to echo the remarks made by Declan Kearney and Emma McCann in relation to Tony Taylor, because I think in the middle of all this there are prisoners who haven't received due process, so therefore that's why sometimes with these arguments or discussions around whether or not prisoners are the same and whether they should be treated the same, and I think we have to come to that with that. But the one thing which I would bring to all of this when people are making their decisions, and there's no doubt that at the heart of this there's political perspectives, people have views, and people have views of how prisoners should be treated. But I think what people should bring to the independent review is the issue of good governance. So whatever your view of the prisoners, whatever your view of the particular individuals and their impact both inside or outside of prison, bring to the discussion good governance. Because in my opinion, and I'll say this, and this is based on of years of experience and indeed talking to prison managers in recent times, forced integration as a policy does not work. And that's what is at the core of the separated regime in McGabbery. That was the recognition, in my opinion, when John Steele made his report in 2003. Forced integration doesn't work. Indeed, it makes prisons very, very difficult to manage. So therefore, see it in the context of McGabbery. Anne Orr, when she made her report in 2011, said very, very clearly that McGabbery is a difficult prison to manage. Each and every single CJA report reinforces that position. So therefore, when we're trying to steer ourselves out of the last report of the CJA, and people have their own interpretation, sometimes it was, there was a quote made from one of the inspectors, and that was carried, but I think all of us would agree that where McGabbery found itself in the last report is not where it should be. Imagine implanting into that a decision that would force prisoners to integrate. So if McGabbery is difficult to manage in the current circumstances, how much more difficult would it be to manage if we took a decision and supported this motion and say that prisoners should be forced to integrate? If you show me a prison system anywhere in the world in a similar circumstance where the governance of a prison is designed where people are forced to integrate, then I can tell you it hasn't worked and it won't work. And that's why we have put in the amendment. When there is an independent review, we'll certainly will bring that to that report. It's interesting.
I thank Mr. McCartney for giving way, and I am assuming he agrees with his colleague, Mr. Kearney, that one of the functions of a prison is to help prepare prisoners for rehabilitation into society. And on that basis, I would like to ask him how he thinks it is helpful in preparing somebody to go into society based on a shared future and shared space by forcing them to live in a segregated present.
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you very much. They're not forced to live there. They do that by choice. And anybody who has looked at rehabilitation, you can't force anybody into a rehabilitation process. That has to be a process where the prisoner volunteers, works with the prison staff to get the outcome of rehabilitation. So when they go back out, they will be better people. If people choose to opt out of that, you can't force them into rehabilitation either. Your point actually reinforces the point which I'm making. The independent review is the place to bring all these issues. In relation to the Alliance Party, you know, in 2011, Anne Orr explicitly said that McGabbery should be separated into three mini prisons. One would house that particular group of prisoners. That was supported at the time by the Minister, and indeed in broad terms across this Assembly. I heard no objections at the Justice Committee or at the debate in the Assembly where that was the wrong thing to do. It wasn't called the flawed decision then. I think what we're seeing here, and I have to say this, is now opportunities arise with this new world of opposition. They have to find things that just, in my opinion, divides people when it's not necessary. The review will examine all the issues. The review should examine all the issues. But I say this here, and I say it with confidence, that if you talk privately to prison managers, they will tell you forced integration in McGabbery will ensure that the next report from the CJA will be worse than the reports that we've had up to date. So we will not be supporting the motion.
Call Mr. Sammy Douglas.
Mr. Speaker, and I rise as a member of the Justice Committee, and I certainly welcome this debate. And when I look back at the Justice Committee, I realise that these issues have been raised a number of times. So I think it's quite timely that we have this debate and we look at the way forward, and part of that way forward is having the prison review to go through that. But like Doug Biddy, who paid tribute to the bravery of the prison officers, I would certainly reiterate that, Mr. Speaker, in terms of their commitment and their dedication. And over the years, many of those people have paid the ultimate sacrifice, and just March of this year, one of my neighbours down the road, Adrian Ismay, paid ultimate sacrifice himself. In one sense, we have a problem, and often I've been involved in mediation between various groups over the years. One of the things I came to realise is if there's a problem, let's name it. And Brendan McGuigan, who is the Chief Inspector of the Northern Ireland Criminal Justice Inspection, came along to our committee on a couple of occasions. And he said the separate regime for dissident Republicans and loyalists at McGabbery Jail was a disproportionate drain on resources that require a radical new approach. And that's what we're looking for, no matter how long it's going to take us. because they are taking up a disproportionate amount of senior management, attention and resources to deliver an unrestricted regime, often at the expense of the rest of the prison population. And there are major issues surrounding McGebbery Prison. But, Mr Speaker, could I say we're not alone. My colleague, Alistair Ross, when he was chairman of our committees, said at the time, we often talk about McGebbery being one of the most complex prisons in Europe and somewhat unique, and we agree that. But within Great Britain now, there are Islamist terrorists being kept within prison, so there are similar sorts of challenges one would imagine. And it's interesting, at this point in time, the government is investigating the specialist units on the mainland. Convicted extremists who promote terror and violence are to be isolated from the general prison population and placed in new specialist units under plans to be announced by the government. So, in one sense, we're not alone. And in one sense, the British government has realised they have a major problem in terms of the young Muslims been radicalised within the prison. So we're not alone. So there has to be a recognition that there is a problem. And the minister, the minister said probably just this morning that integration was generally best. I think we all agree that. But she went on to say, but if not done right, I'm paraphrasing her, this will have a serious and disruptive impact on good order, discipline and security of the prison as a whole. Mr Speaker, we need to ensure that the security and the safety of prison officers is at the heart of what changes that come about. It doesn't matter when that is. Is it 4 years as part of the Fresh Start Agreement, or is it Doug Beattie's 9 years or 10 years or whatever? So we certainly don't want to exacerbate the situation. But I look at this situation similar to Peacelines, where I live a mile from Peaceline. I would love to see every Peaceline in Northern Ireland taken down. The reality is the people living in those communities, people living behind the peace walls, they will not argue for those to come down until they feel safe, until they feel that they're not going to bed at night, there's a petrol bomb or a brick coming through their window. And this is a similar situation in terms of prison officers. And I've spoken to some prison officers. Of course, we want to see change, but it has to be done in a managed and professional way, taking in what the Minister is saying today.
Member, conclude his remarks. Yeah,
don't do this in a disciplined fashion. It will come back to haunt us all. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
Call Mr Robbie Butler.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. And like many of the members here today, I'd like to go on record in thanking my former colleagues in the prison service for the bravery and the work that they do under arduous circumstances. I would like to welcome this opportunity to support Doug Beattie on this motion, which I believe is critical to the continued viability of McGebbery Prison. I feel that I am in a unique position to speak on this motion today. I speak with the benefit of having 4 years' experience working as a prison officer in McGebbery Prison from 1996 to 2000, which I feel was the hardest job that I have done to date. I have first-hand experience of the difficulties that are faced by staff, particularly with regard to safety and management of facilities and resources. Also, living just outside McGebbery, and myself representing Lagan Valley, in this chamber gives me a unique insight into the issues that are faced there. And quite frankly, my main concern is one of safety. Safety for the officers, safety for the uniformed staff or the non-uniformed staff, and safety for the prisoners. And there's no reason why we can't have all three. However, as has already clearly been evidenced today, the current policy of prisoner segregation is not working. In no way does it increase the safety of staff or prisoners. In fact, it undermines it. The decision in 2003 to enforce prisoner segregation, whilst flawed at the time, in my opinion, makes even less sense today in 2016. It does promote a two-tier prison service, which only heightens tensions within the prison, and it perpetuates the false narrative that we have political prisoners. That the staff and even the families of staff, that is my family that I'm talking about here today, have had and continue to have their personal safety jeopardised from the outworkings of prisoner segregation. It's disgusting. Did the deaths of David Black or Adrian Ismay further a peaceful political cause? The truth is, absolutely not. They were murdered. I cannot accept the mantra that we are still living in a peace process with ongoing political prisoners. At what point do we as a society finally move from a process into normality? And surely, as we seek to integrate our society and our societal differences more and more, why then do we allow ourselves to be haunted by the spectre of the past? We now find ourselves at a critical juncture with regards to making history. By not allowing the mistakes of the past to influence good decision making, and then to accept and recognise the amendment by Sinn Féin, would be to legitimise an artificial regime, one which would tell us that we have not learned from our mistakes of the past and perpetuates the executive's inability to develop Mays Long Cash for the people of Lagan Valley and indeed Northern Ireland. Not forgetting, as has been well covered today, the purpose of custodial establishments like McGabbery. There is a duty on the Justice Minister and the Executive to ensure the safety and well-being of staff, visitors and inmates. And I can tell you, resources are stretched to breaking point. I am in regular contact with former colleagues who are concerned not only for their own well-being, but that of fellow colleagues and prisoners as well. The strain of the current regime at McGabbery cannot and should not be maintained indefinitely, as has been suggested. And this is not solely for financial reasons, but for the added impact on the mental health, the poor mental health impact that it is having on staff and prisoners alike. I wholeheartedly commend this motion by my party colleague, and I believe that 9 or 10 years is more than generous, Mr Beattie, with which to normalise the prison service at McGabbery, and we have more than enough time to do this. Thank you.
Call Mr Eamon McCann.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. I wasn't expecting to be called. It's a pleasure. So let me say, Mr Speaker, first, that when we talk about McGabbery Prison, and when we talk about the changes that have been made in McGabbery and the problems that have arisen in McGabbery, we ought to look back a wee bit further than the last couple of years. We've heard mention the case of Sean Lynch, the case of Patrick Kelly. Afterwards, of course, we have had all manner of assurances that lessons have been learnt and that things are going to change. I will put it to the members who have made those arguments or made those observations about McGabbery to ask themselves whether all the problems, all the difficulties, all the inadequacies which have been referred to in relation to those cases were clear to be seen in the case of Annie Kelly, age 19, who hanged herself from the wire mesh covering of the window in her cell back in 2003. At that time, there were extensive inquiries, clear-cut and explicit, ringing declarations that all the problems which have been identified would be seen to. And indeed, I have had from the Minister for Justice, in answer to a question recently, a suggestion that the defects in the prison service at that time had been remedied. Annie Kelly's family from Strabane, to whom I have been speaking in recent days, are still waiting for some explanation as to how a 19-year-old child whose problems have been widely signalled, including by the prison staff. Indeed, may I say, Mr Speaker, that a senior member of the prison staff at McGabbery at that time wrote to Annie Kelly's solicitor, and I've seen the letter, saying that we, that is, the prison staff, knew that Annie Kelly should not be in McGabbery, that there was no place for her, and saying explicitly, that she was in danger of harming herself and even of suicide. Now, and that was said, and then she does commit suicide, we are entitled to ask questions about the overall regime in McGabbery and entitled to ask whether the present situation and the present regime and the present authorities would be capable, if not assuming that they're mindful, to manage the transition suggested in this motion in a proper and legitimate way. I can tell you now that if you make people, and Mr. McCartney, I think, was coming close to saying the same thing, if you impose integration on the prisoners at McGabbery, you will not solve any problem. You will reap a whirlwind. You are going to have serious violence within the prison. Now, I don't say that with any sense of pleasure or anticipation of it happening. I'm simply telling you that, in my view, my judgment, based on my experience of campaigning on these matters and my knowledge of a prisoner, some of them in McGabbery at the moment, I have no doubt that you'll be making a very serious mistake to try to push this. The point was made, I think, by Mr. Douglas a couple of moments ago. That is simply not the case, that all prisoners are regarded as having equal status in this jurisdiction, in the southern jurisdiction, or across the water. The very fact, we heard a few moments ago, that all the prisoners are the same. They are not the same. If a prisoner is in McGabbery on the basis of the signature of a Secretary of State, not on the basis of having been brought to court on any charge, if that is the situation, and it is in the case of Tony Taylor, then we have established clearly, that establishes clearly, that there are differences in status. If Tony Taylor is not a political prisoner, what type of prisoner is he? Because he's certainly not a convicted prisoner. So what I'm saying here is that when we deal with, and incidentally, separation in McGabbery, when we begin to look at separation in our schools, maybe we can move on to the more difficult question. If children were allowed to learn multiplication tables in the same room, then perhaps we'll have some ground of principle on which to stand to say that prisoners should be kept in the same accommodation. That's not going to work. But also, my main point, Mr. Speaker, and to make this final point, is this. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. That we should look back. When I hear that Annie Kelly's case has been resolved to the satisfaction of her family, I'll take this motion seriously.
Call Mr. Edwin Poots, who will have 2 minutes.
Just to say that at the outset, we will not be supporting either the motion or indeed the amendment. The motion is flawed in that it identifies that the Steele report itself was wrong in the first instance, but then goes on to take 9 years to unravel it. And if it is worth going to end the separation of prisoners, it's worth doing it on a much faster basis. I can't have only 2 minutes. On a much faster basis than over the course of 9 years, which I believe is wholly and completely flawed. But what we won't expect from a party whose previous policy in prison was to allow the prisoners out and to allow them to go free. Whenever you see weak policy coming from a party which agreed to free the prisoners in the first instance, that doesn't come as any surprise. What is absolutely important here, Mr. Speaker, is the safety of the prison. And over the course of the last 5 years, I would have to say that the prison in McGabbery is a much less safe place to be, both for prisoners and for prison staff, than it was before. And there has been an absolute failure in terms of prisons over the course of the previous 5 years. And I wish the existing minister well, but she will have to listen to the people who are on the ground and not ignore the people who are on the ground. Our staff are hugely important, wealth of experience, and to have that dismissed and to fly people in from England to stay in the Culloden to run our prisons and fly them back again after spending 2 or 3 days here was a failed means of carrying out the running of our prisons. We need to be listening to the people on the ground and identifying the issues that they're raising with us, and ensure that their voices are heard and our prisons are better managed. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I call the Minister of Justice, Ms. Clare Sugden, to respond. Ms. Clare Sugden will have up to 15 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would like to thank the members, Mr. Beattie and Mr. Beggs, for bringing this very important issue to the Assembly, and also those who have tabled an amendment. I do welcome the opportunity to debate this in the Chamber today. It's often something that we don't tend to talk about, but I do think it's important that we do. Mr. Speaker, the Northern Ireland Prison Service has a very important role to play in keeping Northern Ireland safe against the backdrop of a continuing threat from dissident republicanism and all types of paramilitarism. And no one should underestimate the considerable challenges that arise from having separated areas for paramilitary prisoners in McGabbery Prison. In accepting the recommendations of the Steel Review Team report in 2003, the government at the time committed to providing separate accommodation for paramilitary prisoners who, on the grounds of their personal safety, wished to be held apart from prisoners belonging to other paramilitary groups and prisoners who belonged to no such groups. The rationale for that decision was that separation provided the best option for improving conditions at McGabbery Prison, particularly in relation to the safety of all staff and prisoners. Some may question the efficacy of that decision and cite the challenges that operating a separated regime within McGabbery has posed since its introduction in 2004 as evidence that it was a flawed decision. However, it is important to remember that the review was commissioned in response to violent clashes between rival groups with the integrated population of McGabbery Prison at that time and in the face of a dirty protest by some prisoners. As members are aware, decisions on who can be admitted to the separated conditions are made by prison staff acting under the direction of the Secretary of State. The Secretary of State also has responsibility for setting the criteria under which applications for separation are considered. The operation and management of the separated regime, however, is the responsibility of the Prison Service. It is provided at McGabbery Prison with Bush House for Loyalist prisoners and Row House for Republican prisoners. At present, there are a total of 42 prisoners in separation, 16 in Bush and 26 in Row. Mr. Speaker, I want to be very clear that from the outset, contrary to opinion, the arrangements for separation in McGabbery are very different to those that existed previously in prisons in Northern Ireland. A key principle of Steel was that the government would never again concede to complete control of landings in a prison, as had happened at the Maze. Separation at McGabbery Prison today is not the same as Maze-style segregation, which allowed prisoners to be unlocked continuously and saw the withdrawal of staff from the landings. The Prison Service ensures that the separated landings, as in the case with the rest of the prison, are controlled by staff and not by prisoners. Mr. Speaker, there will not be a return to Maze-like conditions. As far as possible, the Prison Service strives to deliver a regime consistent with that of the integrated population, whilst equally cognisant of the fact that many of these prisoners are in custody because they have committed very serious offences. However, as the motion notes, there are consequences to operating a separated regime, and it is most despicable that some members of our society have sought to use it as justification against attacks against prison staff, including the awful murders of David Black and Adrian Ismay. Attacks such as these and the ongoing intimidation of staff are issues of grave concern to me and are entirely unacceptable. Mr. Speaker, I know that working in such an environment can have far-reaching impact upon the lives of the staff who are affected and their families. And the determination of both prison staff and management to continue to deliver a positive and constructive regime against such a challenging backdrop cannot be commended. And I will listen to the people on the ground, and help, you know, so that I can best understand how to support them and how I can ask my department to support them. McGabbery can be a very stressful environment to work in, and I want to make sure that adequate support is made available to all of my prison officers in this respect. I am committed to ensuring that specific training continues to be provided to me and staff to maintain staff resilience and prevent conditioning, that appropriate arrangements are in place to ensure that officers working in separated conditions are rotated on a regular basis and have the opportunity to work in different areas of the prison, and that, where needed, prison officers are provided with the appropriate supports and their services to provide this environment have an impact on their mental health and well-being. Notwithstanding the impact on staff, operating a separated regime within the confines of a normal prison presents us with a number of other significant challenges. Whilst the prisoners held in separation accounts for less than 5% of the total population of 919, the management of separated accommodation places significant pressures on the Northern Ireland Prison Service in a number of ways, including the staffing resource required to manage this challenging group of prisoners, the ability to establish and maintain a stable, normalised regime without impacting upon safety and security, and the provision of services and interventions which meet the needs of, this segment of the population. These are the very real challenges that operational staff in Macgarvie face on a daily basis, and I wish to put on record my very real appreciation for their continued dedication and professionalism. Prison officers serve the entire community in Northern Ireland, and I am so grateful for their commitment and dedication to this service. It is also the case that prisoners in separation require a disproportionate amount of senior management attention. As reflected in the motion, Macgarvie Prison is unique. It is a large and complex prison, and the requirement to provide a separated regime is undoubtedly a significant contributory factor to this complexity. Management decisions are made in the context of intense public and political scrutiny, and it is often necessary to balance considerations in respect of issues such as controlled movement and searching arrangements against ensuring a safe and secure environment is maintained. It also means addressing the impact that such decisions may have on the safety of both staff inside and outside of the prison, and the impact that, managing a resource-intense, separated area has upon the rest of the prison, and this is not an easy balance to achieve. The motion makes reference to the Executive's action plan on tackling paramilitary activity, criminality and organised crime. And I fully agree that the three-person panel report and the Executive plan provide important context for the discussion around this motion today. Members will be aware that the Executive published its action plan on tackling paramilitary activity, which set out our initial response to the three-person panel report on disbanding paramilitary groups, and sought to draw together the recommendations made by the panel and the commitments made in Fresh Start on the 19th of July. That response demonstrates the Executive's intention to develop a strategic approach to this programme for work, and for that reason the action plan is based on four themes set out in the three-person panel report, which are promoting lawfulness, support for transition, tackling criminal activity and addressing systemic issues. The action plan outlines a combination of approaches to tackling the issue of paramilitary activity and associated criminality, recognising the importance of a strong law enforcement response to the threats created by this issue, but whilst also noting the need to support communities in transition and focus on a preventative work, particularly in relation to young people who may be susceptible to becoming involved in paramilitary activity. Importantly, the independent three-person panel report recognised that the time is not yet right to end separation. It did, however, note that the ultimate aim must be to secure an end to the end of a separated regime for paramilitary prisoners as we move to a more normal and peaceful society. And Mr. Speaker, I agree. Having noted that this is a longer-term commitment, the panel recommended that the DOJ revisit the framework related to the separated regime and arrange for an independent review to be undertaken to examine the operation of this regime. Mr. Speaker, I have accepted the panel's recommendation and have instructed officials within my department to develop terms of reference for an independent review and identify the stakeholders that will need to be engaged in this process. Work has also begun to identify individuals with the necessary skills to lead this review. The review, when complete, will provide me with a report and a number of recommendations in respect of the future of separated conditions in the Northern Ireland Prison Service. Mr. Speaker, in summing up, there are a number of points I would like to make. I absolutely recognise the difficulties associated with operating a separated regime in Macgarvie Prison and the challenge it presents on a daily basis to both staff and the operational work that goes on. And I believe that accommodating prison in normal integrated prison accommodation is the most appropriate approach to the management of prisons in Northern Ireland, as it provides the best opportunities for rehabilitation and successful reintegration into community upon release. However, it is clear to me that as long as prisoners who refuse to integrate into the normal prison population remain, it is my duty to ensure that the safest possible conditions exist for both staff and prisoners. I believe that forcing these prisoners to do so would have a serious disruptive effect on the good order, discipline and security of the prison as a whole. And as I have already stated, the three-person panel report noted that our ultimate aim must be to secure the end of a separated regime for paramilitary prisoners. But it is only in the context of a more normal and peaceful society that a proper discussion about the timescale for an end to separation can take place. In the meantime, I am fully committed to deliver on the panel's recommendation in respect of separation, which is to revisit the framework and arrange for an independent review to be carried out. I don't disagree with the intent of the motion, because we should aspire to end separation. And we have already committed to ending all paramilitarism through Fresh Start, and maybe it will happen in 9 years, but it needs to happen in a more peaceful and safer Northern Ireland. But we cannot underestimate the current severe threat that exists, that has claimed the lives of two prison officers and threatens officers daily. Members are correct, we need to address separation. However, focus needs to be on the right solution and the safest environment for prison officers and wider society. Mr. Speaker, I cannot support the motion that focuses on a time frame rather than the right solution. We have committed to a solution through Fresh Start, and it is a high-level series of actions to be taken in response to the recommendations by the three-person panel. And to address Mr. Attwood's comments about the action plan and progress, there will be an independent review, as already stated. I don't have a time frame for you today, but it is not sitting on a shelf. We are developing it. The terms of reference are in development and work is progressing. The action plan was a high-level acceptance of our commitment, Mr. Speaker, to tackle paramilitarism. This is not an easy issue. It's not an overnight fix. It's not even a 5 months fix. I think to expect anything sooner is irresponsible. I believe that the correct mechanism for delivering progress in respect of the challenging issues that result from the separation of prisoners at Macgabry are through the action plan in response to the three-person panel report. Thank you.
I call Ms. Jennifer McCann to wind on the amendment, and the member will have up to 5 minutes.
Can I just say at the outset, you know, I want to, you know, that the main motion here that we have seen the Ulster Unionist Party bring forward really it beggars belief because, I mean, the proposer was quite, you know, exercised in his support for the Fresh Start Agreement, and the fact that they don't even support the Fresh Start Agreement, I think, makes it a bit ridiculous that he was quoting pieces out of it and picking and choosing pieces which he wants to support. So I just want to first of all say that obviously we've heard from a lot of speakers here today, and our amendment, which I'm going to wind on, I think gives the best possible outcome in terms of what we want to do within the prisons. And we really want what we're about in the prisons is about making the prisons manageable, but also, you know, for to have those conditions and to have human dignity, decency and respect, both for prisoners and the staff in prisons, that has to be paramount here. And that's what I think our amendment actually does in this case. People have spoken about and I just want to go very quickly over it, people have spoken about the 2010 August Agreement. And the 2010 August Agreement was an agreement that took a lot of time and a lot of energy by independent facilitators getting into the prison, speaking not only to the prisoners, but speaking to the prison staff and the managers of the prison. And they went and they actually came up with a number of recommendations that suggested controlled movement and strip searches should be stopped, and the prison officers should be allowed to do their jobs without fear of threat or intimidation. And that, at that time, seemed to be the best agreement that was put forward in terms of all the people involved. You know, we saw the to and fro and what happened whenever that agreement wasn't put in place. So I would just like to say that you know, as my colleagues here have said, the forced integration of prisoners doesn't work. And I think it was Sammy Douglas actually crystallised it. You don't force people on the outside to live together, so how can you force people on the inside to live together? We have to get to a place where people want to do that. And I think that the reality is that for now, we're not at that place in Macgabry Prison, and I think that that's what people need to be realistic and take cognizance of. I just want to go through then some of the things that people said. The proposer of the amendment, my colleague Declan Kearney, mentioned that all prison staff and all prisoners and their families should be treated with dignity and respect, and that neither prisoners or prison staff should be degraded in any way. And he quite rightly pointed out that, the motion's proposer mentioned and quoted the Fresh Start, quite exercised by it, but actually opposed the agreement at the time, the party did. And again, it went into the issue of the security mindset needing to be replaced by a rehabilitation culture. And we saw what happened in the prisons years ago when that security mindset was forced into the prisons. And we need to see that it's about rehabilitation and it's about treating people with dignity and respect. And that goes right across the board. And I'm not just saying for prisoners, but it has to be for prisoners and prison staff as well. He then went on to point out to the case of Sean Kelly, the recent case from Derry, and I have to say, you know, that it was most traumatic even listening to that young man's father when you listen to him on the news and about how his son had blinded himself, and then listen to Sean Kelly himself. And I think that we need to look at the treatment and how people, particularly, and I know a number of members mentioned this, how prisoners with mental health issues are actually treated in those prisons. It's not the place for them, and I agree with even some of the staff would tell you that there, that it's not the place for them. And how those people, you know, and quite a lot of people mentioned other people as well who had taken their own lives in prison. And I think that's something that we really, really need to, in any review, we need to be looking at of how those people shouldn't be in prison in the first place when they have issues, that's those severe mental health issues that they have. And again, the prison environment, I think it's a very, very key point, and my colleague Raymond McCartney made this as well, that the prison environment should be kept free from all outside political interference. That's crucial, because that's not what prison's about. Prison isn't about us coming here and battling out wee motions and everything else that the opposition seem to be doing over this period. Prison is there for the care of prisoners and the rehabilitation
of
prisoners.
Ask the member to conclude her remarks.
Okay, sorry. So just very, very quickly, I want to say that our focus should be on making McGabbery a stable, stress-free and safe environment for all staff, prisoners and those who visit the prison, as my colleague Declan Kearney said in the amendment, and I want to say that I support the amendment.
Call Mr Roy Beggs to wind up the debate on the motion, and the member has up to 10 minutes.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Like my colleague Doug Beattie and many others, I would like to start my comments by praising prison officers' staff for their dedication and professionalism in the very difficult environment in which we place them to look after prisoners on our behalf, and the fact that the system that we have set up results in shortages and difficulties from them in trying to do their job as best they wish. There were other comments from Paul Frew, Trevor Lund, Sammy Douglas, Robbie Butler and Pam Cameron, and indeed the Minister in recognising this during the course of the debate. My colleague Doug has highlighted that the motion that we have crafted is an attempt to dovetail into the Fresh Start and the Action Plan to end paramilitary activity. Because if you're going to end paramilitary activity outside of prison, we also need to work to end the arrangements for segregation of paramilitaries inside the prison, where they do have undue influence. He'd indicated that segregation was introduced in haste in 2003, against the wishes of the prison governors, the Prison Officers Association and the Northern Ireland Affairs Committee. Adopted within a month, and we still have it today. And yet many in this chamber are saying a maximum of 9 years isn't sufficient to plan to have it removed. Some say that it's too long. But if you look at the motion we've said by 2001 and by 2026, that it should be completely over. If there is willingness, it can be done much, much sooner, and I hope that that would be the case. So it's false to criticise it on those longer time frames. turning on then to some other aspects that were said, it is important that this Assembly indicates its view on this matter, because ultimately the Secretary of State does have a role in bringing about that change. Like Doug Beattie, Alex Atwood highlighted the need to deal with the separated regime, and he specifically indicated the difficulty with there being a segregated regime or separate regime in the Republic as well as Northern Ireland. I agree that's an issue that needs dealt with. Again, the time frame envisaged should allow that to easily happen if there is goodwill. Today this Assembly faces stark choice, the choice between the motion in the name of Doug Beattie and myself, which sees a normal society and prison system, and the torturous language of the amendment from Sinn Féin, which can be easily read as blaming our court system for a separated regime in our prisons. When you look carefully at the initial wording, that's how it can be easily interpreted. 2016 is 20 years after the announcement of the paramilitary ceasefires, 18 years after the Belfast Agreement. Surely that's long enough for change to happen. Why do we have any paramilitary prisoners? That's the question that must be asked. The motion calls for no fresh admission by 2021. So let's endeavour to have it sooner, and the end of separation by 2026. Again, let's have it sooner. There's a vision of integrating prisoners within the Executive's Action Plan for tackling paramilitary activity, criminality and organised crime. And again, many spoke about the need to do this. It needs to happen in the prisons as well and outside society. Most of the units have been in the fore in moving Northern Ireland towards a normal society. And we believe the decision to establish separated wings was a flawed decision in 2003. And again, as my colleague Robbie Butler very ably explained, if the decision was flawed then, the experience that we've seen since shows that it's still flawed today, and even more so, particularly as a result of the violence that we have seen and how prison officers have been attacked in their homes, and indeed prison officer Black and Ismay have lost their lives. Some of the DUP members, Paul Frew, for instance, spoke of his opposition, his party's opposition to separating prisoners. So then it was surprised that I heard later on that Eden Putz indicated that their party would be voting against the motion. I can't explain that one. There can be little doubt that by concentrating paramilitary prisoners in separated wings, there is a significant adverse effect on other aspects of the prison, on the morale of prison officers, and indeed this also has consequences outside our jails. The 2015 Criminal Justice Inspection Report is also damning of the current arrangement, which gives special treatment to paramilitary prisoners. Paragraph 548 regarding separated units, it highlights that they only provide a containment function, that they consume a disproportionate amount of staff and management resources to the detriment of the population, the wider population of prisoners, and that staffing levels are prioritised regardless of what happens elsewhere within the prison, and that was also highlighted by Sammy Douglas. The report highlights then other aspects, the knock-on effects of that. It immediately then turns to the inadequate care of vulnerable prisoners, and this was something that Eamon McCann highlighted. But when you take prison officers away from other sections of the prison, regardless of the impact to those other sections, and you maintain the separate regime to a very high level, including playing football at lunchtime when everybody else is locked down, guess what? Mistakes happen, things go wrong. So there are consequences with blindly going forward maintaining a separated unit. There are consequences in prioritising staff from the rest of the prison and actually creating more favourable conditions in the separated unit. I recall it was Alec Atwood had highlighted the issue that how people enter it is highly questionable. And there's even the question, are people thinking about, oh, you're better off if you move into this segregated unit? Is the system encouraging people to indicate and to ultimately link up with paramilitary organisations in order to benefit from the segregated unit? It's vitally important that we do not encourage and maintain such structures and possibly even contribute to recruitment. Other aspects of the report indicated that during the day of the inspection, that the male facility was closed due to staff shortages. No doubt they were providing supervision for football in the segregated unit. Something like that. The important aspect of male for all prisoners was not being able to facilitate it. Managers, paragraph 2.12 then indicated managers and staff told us that a large proportion of staff sickness was caused by the working conditions in row house, with staff shortages being met by staff from other houses. Just what I've been saying here. The Minister in her response indicated that there was training for staff resilience and rotation of staff with the segregated wings. But still what I am picking up is there is this chill factor, this difficulty for prison officers operating in the segregated units. And what is that because of the concentration of the prisoners who think that they can dominate and impose their wish on even the staff? Well, some spoke of the fact that the prisoners did not control the wings. There is undoubted that they have an influence, an undue influence. I think we benefit greatly from hearing from Robbie Butler and his experience, and I thank him for that. And obviously his concern for officers, for non-uniformed staff, and indeed the prisoners. And it was he who highlighted that segregation was not working. Turning to the amendment, I'm particularly concerned at the language that it says, referring to McGabbery, it challenges that phases in result of housing prisoners with diverse backgrounds who are subject to different court processes depending on the nature of their charges. It was almost saying it's because of these court processes that we have the segregated units. It's all the court's fault. Much of Europe does not have jury. That is actually a British judicial tradition, something I would wish to uphold. It's reflected largely in the Republic of Ireland as well. But when there is threats to jurors, and I actually recall recently earlier this year an item which epitomises why there's a difficulty. And there was a Fianna Fáil councillor in February this year who highlighted the need for a special criminal court in the Republic. They couldn't get 12 jurors from 729 people for a case in Limerick.
It's important that we protect the jury system,
we protect the justice system, and we do not allow courts to take the blame. We must move forward as a community and create an integrated prison just as an integrated society. Thank you.
Members, as questions.
I will now put the question on the amendment and the motion. The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no.
No.
I think the noes have.
No.
All those, we'll just test it again just to be sure. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye. Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes.
Order. Order. Members will resume their seats. Order. Members will resume their seats. The question is, order. The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Jennifer McCann and Raymond McCartney. Tellers for the noes are Doug Beattie and Steve Aiken. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Order. Members will resume their seats. And I'll ask the clerk to read the result.
65 members voted, 50 members voted aye, 15 members voted no, 30 members who voted in both lobbies are not included in these results. The amendment is therefore agreed.
Unfasten the door. Amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary no.
No.
Aye. Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Order. Members will resume their seats. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary if any no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Thank you. Order. Members will resume their seats. Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Jennifer McCann and Raymond McCartney. Tellers for the noes are Doug Beattie and Steve Aiken. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Eyes to my right, noes to my left. secure the doors. Order. Members will resume their seats, and I'll ask the clerk to read the result.
65 members voted, 50 members voted aye, 15 members voted no, 30 members who voted in both lobbies are not included in these results. The motion is carried.
I will now put the question on the amendment and the motion. The question is, that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye.
contrary, no.
No.
I think the noes have.
No.
All the, we'll just test it again, just to be sure. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye. Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Order. Order. Members will resume their seats. Order. Members will resume their seats. The question is, order. The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Jennifer McCann and Raymond McCartney. Tellers for the noes are Doug Beattie and Steve Aiken. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Order. Members will resume their seats. And I'll ask the clerk to read the result.
65 members voted, 50 members voted aye, 15 members voted no, 30 members who voted in both lobbies are not included in these results. The amendment is therefore agreed.
Unfasten the door. The amendment be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye.
Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Order. Members will resume their seats. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Thank you. Order. Members will resume their seats. Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Jennifer McCann and Raymond McCartney. Tellers for the noes are Doug Beattie and Steve Aiken. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Order. Members will resume their seats, and I'll ask the clerk to read the result.
65 members voted, 50 members voted aye, 15 members voted no, 30 members who voted in both lobbies are not included in these results. The motion is carried.